Welcome to the March 7th worship service for the Robinson Avenue Church of Christ. I'm Gary Turner, one of the elders. I'm glad you're here with us today. I hope this is a time of rejoicing and praise as we sing and we worship our Lord. You know, 52 weeks, I've heard, makes a year. And it was 52 weeks ago we had our last Sunday morning Bible class at Robinson Avenue. It's been a long time. And today we're so grateful because we open up again our kids' classes. Those kids from birth all the way up to sixth grade will have classes available for all these kids today. And they've been eagerly awaiting this day. When we were announcing last Sunday about this, I saw so many kids in church just turn and just so happy about this opportunity. So we thank the elders and deacons, all those teachers that are working on this. There's been a lot of work and effort put into it and a lot of planning. And I especially want to thank Cynthia Voss, our minister for children's education, who is leading our effort on reopening these classes. Cynthia, thank you. You know, 52 weeks makes a long time also for some of our members who've not been back at church because they're afraid of the COVID. And so it's been a long time since I've seen some of you. I've talked to you on the phone, but I sure miss getting to be there with you. I'm hoping that as we start to open up and as the virus goes away, you'll be joining us pretty soon. Because, you know, I worry about your spiritual growth, your spiritual life. Many of you have told me on the phone, yes, I'm doing a daily devotional, or I'm studying this. I've heard different things people are studying or how they're getting filled. And I appreciate them, all of you, making the effort for this. But I think there's something to be said for being together again, and I'm hoping that that occurs pretty soon. You know, this is the year after last year's struggles of anger and hatred that we are really working on the love first philosophy. We are working on building love in our life. Last week we had a great lesson about love is kind. And this week we are going to have a great lesson from chapter 10 in this book, Love is Not Envious. You know, I don't know about you, but I have a natural tendency to be envious. I look at what other people have sometimes, and I'm a little jealous. You know, if you wanted to learn how to be envious, you'd have a hard time finding a class that would teach you that, because we naturally are envious. We just intuitively want things. I've always found it interesting that of the Ten Commandments, nine of them are about the actions you do, but the last one, the tenth one, is about your heart, that you shall not be covetous. And I think this is an important, a very important godly virtue that we need in our life. And so I'm looking forward to our lesson today from our minister, Keith Kilmer, about love is not envious. And I hope you look forward to that in this worship service too. So I want you to put your heart into this today. Put your heart into this worship. Be ready to soak it in and be ready to learn and to experience what we're about to experience. Let's pray for our worship today. Let's pray for the kids that are going to be in classes. Let's pray for our own spiritual development. Lord, we thank you so much for what you've done for us. We are very grateful. We want not to be envious, Lord. We want to be wholly filled and satisfied with what you give us. And so we pray you'd bless us today as we worship you. We pray a special prayer, Heavenly Father, for those kids that are going to be in classes today. I know that they are going to be so joyous and so happy with what happens. We pray that your word starts soaking into them and that these kids grow to be fine, outstanding Christian leaders. We're so grateful, Heavenly Father, for what you can do in the lives of these kids. So we pray you'd bless us Help us in our spiritual growth, whatever way we are trying to grow. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm pressing on the upward way. New heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand. By faith on heaven's stable land. A higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay. Where doubts arise.
It shall rule there. with us
would remain.
Greater love there could not be. Jesus died for you and me.
In our hearts
he would reign.
Listen to a lot of country music, but occasionally when I'm in the mood, I might turn the dial of the radio over to the country station. I listened to a little bit more of it when we lived in Sulphur Springs, Texas, because that's what everyone there listened to. But last time I turned the dial in the car radio to a country station, I happened upon a song, and the title of the song was Love Ain't. I don't even know who sings it. Some of you are probably more familiar with the song than I am. But the chorus of the song, a line from the chorus, says, I may not know what love is, girl, but I know what love ain't. And the verses go on to describe that love ain't a one-night stand. I think most of us would agree with that. Love ain't getting stood up. Love ain't being miserable in a relationship. Well, the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, his grammar is better than that. But I think Paul would agree that sometimes in order to define what love is, we must first define what love is not. And so we've spent the last couple weeks talking about what love is. Love is patient. Love is kind. But the next eight descriptions that Paul gives of love in 1 Corinthians chapter 13 concern what love is not. And so let's look in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and I'm going to start the reading at the middle of verse 4 and end the reading about the middle of verse 6. Love does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not rejoice in evil. And so eight descriptions here that Paul gives us of what love is not. It's not envious. It's not boastful. Love is not proud. It's not dishonoring. It's not self-seeking. It's not angry. Love is not vindictive. And if any of those things are in your heart, if you're always jealous of what others have, or if you stay angry most of the time and have a short fuse, and if you're not always putting your own needs ahead of the needs of others, you're not being perfected in love. Love ain't those things. Love isn't like that. Love is something different. And the first item on this list of don'ts, of love is not, the first item on the list is love does not envy. And understand, when Paul says that to the church in Corinth, we need to remember that this is something that Paul has raised the red flag and sounded the alarm. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. 1 Corinthians 3, 1 through 4. Brothers and sisters, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly, mere infants in Christ. I gave you milk, not solid food, for if you were not ready for it, you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. You are still worldly. For since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? Are you not acting like mere humans? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another says, I follow Apollos, are you not mere humans? And so here, this is the continuation of the thought that Paul started back in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 6 and 7, where he contrasts the wisdom of the age with godly wisdom. And God's wisdom is revealed by the Spirit. And the Spirit, Paul goes on to explain, helps us to understand spiritual realities and also helps us to discern what is good and what is right. But Paul's frustration with these Christians is that he can't even address them as spiritual people. Their feet are too firmly planted in the world. And the evidence of that is their quarreling and their jealousy. And their grammatical construction makes it clear that those two things are related to one another. Quarreling and jealousy, arguing and envy. Those things pair together. They're twins. They're like cells that bond and bind to each other. They're not ready for these deeper spiritual truths that they should be growing in. They're still dieting on milk and not meat. They're like infants. He has what I don't have. She has what I want. And it sounds like this is a problem that continued in Corinth, because when we get to 2 Corinthians, Paul says this: I'm afraid that when I come to you, I might not find you as I want you to be. I fear that there may be discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, slander, gossip, arrogance, and disorder. And so if they want to get unstuck in their spiritual lives, they have to move beyond this envy and jealousy that is characterizing their lives and their behavior. Recently, I started going to a new health club, and I've been out of the exercise routine for far too long and ready to get back into it. And I walk into this gym, and I think, you know, the people that are here don't need to be here because they look like I want to look. And I could get a little jealous. The worst is when you go to an exercise machine right after a 20 or 30-year-old, and you have to take that pin that's in the weights, and you have to move it up. And so they're down in the triple-digit numbers. Sometimes I have to move it up to the double-digit numbers. Sometimes before I leave the machine, I put the pin back where it was, so the next person will think that I lifted more than I actually did. But here's the thing. If I can't temper my jealousy, I'm never going to get to where I want to get to. I'm always going to be focused on what someone else has and what I don't have. I'm always looking at others rather than looking at myself. And these rivalries in the city of Corinth, in first century Corinth, had seeped into their relationships and had seeped into their assemblies. And Paul reminds them, even in the verses that lead up to the love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13, back in chapter 12, at the end of chapter 12, Paul reminds them, not everyone is an apostle, and not everyone is a teacher, not everyone experienced these miraculous manifestations of the Spirit that some in first century Corinth experienced, but don't be envious of those things. Instead, you grow in love. You seek the most excellent way. Now, and Corinth isn't the only place where Paul sounded that alarm. There were other Christians in other locations that also struggled with this. Paul says it in Romans chapter 13, verse 13. Let us behave decently as in the daytime, not carousing, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. In Galatians chapter 5, Paul speaks of the acts of the flesh. And this comes just before the fruit of the Spirit. Sometimes we focus on the fruit of the Spirit, but we forget this vice list, the acts of the flesh that Paul also gives in Galatians chapter 5. And he says this: the acts of the flesh are obvious. Sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. And so just look at the company that jealousy and envy keep. Most of us wouldn't put jealousy, we wouldn't put envy in the same category as sexual immorality or as idolatry or as orgies. Parents, if your children were struggling with a lot of the things on this list, you would want to get them help yesterday. Oh no, my daughter's into witchcraft. It's worse than I thought. I need to take her to the elders to pray with her. I need to take her to our preacher, get her some counseling. I need to get her help. My son is getting drunk every weekend. We need to have a family intervention. We need to nip this in the bud right away. Now, you would be alarmed by those things, and you would immediately seek help and healing, because we don't want our kids to be in the clutches of some sin. But what if your child were struggling with something like jealousy or envy? No, it's just a phase. They'll get over it. No big deal. Who doesn't struggle with envy and jealousy, right? And yet Paul places jealousy and envy right smack dab in the middle of this list of things that we would consider really big, bad sins, significant things. Why? Why is that the company that jealousy and envy keep? Well, let's look at some words from James, the brother of Jesus, and see what he has to say about this. Look at James chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy, selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you find disorder and every evil practice. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers who sow in peace reap harvest of righteousness. And so James is doing the same thing that Paul did in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. He's contrasting two types of wisdom. Worldly wisdom. Paul calls it the wisdom of this age. James calls it worldly wisdom. He's contrasting that with godly wisdom. And if you follow this chain of events backwards from the evil practices, from the sins, you've got all these evil things that are going on. Well, where does that come from? Well, it comes from envy and selfish ambition. Okay, well, why do people act that way? Well, they act that way because they're following the wisdom of the world. They're not following God's wisdom. Well, what is the source of that worldly wisdom, that counterfeit wisdom? Well, the source of it, James says, is that it's unspiritual and it's demonic. It comes from the devil. The devil will use envy to sow chaos and division. Now, you could go all the way back to the Tower of Babel to find an illustration of this. When we think of that story, we typically think of the time when people started speaking different languages and everyone went their separate ways. I'm sure it was pretty chaotic, but how did it end up that way? Because a group of people got jealous. They wanted to make a name for themselves. Genesis chapter 11, verse 14 says so. Just like James says, where you find envy and selfish ambition, there you will find disorder and every evil practice. And so the question this morning is, how do we end envy? If this is so destructive and counterproductive to our spiritual lives and to our growth and maturity, how do we put an end to envy? Let me give you two words this morning. The first word is hospitality. We might not think of hospitality as this big biblical theme. When we hear the word hospitality, we might perhaps think of the hospitality industry and hotels and resorts. If you've got a conference or a seminar that you attend, you might go to the hospitality center because that's where all the food and the refreshments are. But this word hospitality is found at least on four occasions in the New Testament. Here they are. Romans chapter 12, verse 13 says, share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. 1 Timothy 5, verses 9 and 10. No widow may be put on the list of widows unless she is known for her good deeds, such as, and it gives a list of things, but one of those items is showing hospitality. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 2, do not forget to show hospitality to strangers, for by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 9 says, offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. And that Greek word that's translated in our English Bibles as hospitality is the Greek word philoxenia, which literally means a love for strangers. And so, yes, we are to show hospitality to strangers, but as these passages, these verses show, we also show hospitality to one another. We show hospitality to those who are in the family of God, to our brothers and sisters. And there was a church recently that did a hospitality challenge. That's what they called it. And the leaders called upon their members to invite one other family or one single person in the church, invite them to their home. Everyone had 30 days to accomplish this. This was their hospitality challenge. Everyone needs to invite someone into their home within the next 30 days. Well, you would have thought that by issuing that challenge, they had denied the virgin birth. I mean, people were up in arms about that was being asked of them. And there were three major complaints that people had. Some said, my schedule is just too full. I'm too busy. I can't have anyone into my home. Others said, I don't have time to get my house clean and make it presentable to have someone over. And then some said, I just don't feel comfortable having people into my house. I'm uneasy about that. Well, these wise leaders understood that those complaints weren't really the heart of the issue. Yes, they were busy, and all of us are, but let's be honest, most of us, if we prioritize something, if we were to prioritize having one family or one person over to our home in the next month, we could make time to do that if it was important enough to us. And yes, our homes might be messy, but I'm sure that we could shovel a path between the front door and the kitchen table so that we could have someone into our home and practice hospitality. The preacher addressed the congregation, and he said this, I believe what we are really struggling with is envy, jealousy, and covetousness. We're worried that people with more will look down on our home, or that people with larger homes will feel judged when someone comes for dinner. These are spiritual diseases that create sickness in our souls. See, they felt like practicing hospitality was something that would help them to overcome envy and jealousy. And maybe that's something that we could lean into as well. Practicing hospitality might be one of those things that will help us to end envy, end the jealousy that's in our lives. Here's the second word. The second word is contentment. You realize there's really not an antonym in the English language for envy. I don't know if you've ever thought about that, but there's not really a single word that expresses the exact opposite of envy. Now, that might exist in some other languages, but it really doesn't exist in the English language. In fact, if you looked in Merriam-Webster Dictionary, it gives a list of near antonyms. That's the way it's phrased. Here are some near antonyms for envy, and it lists words like benevolence and goodwill and kindness and sympathy. But I would suggest that the word contentment is about as close as you will get to finding an antonym for the word envy. Now, Paul says this in Philippians chapter 4. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation. Whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want, I could do all this through him who gives me strength. And Paul is writing to Christians who were in better shape than he was at the time. Paul was writing, this is one of the prison epistles, Paul is writing from prison, and they were in the position, these Christians, to support him, to help him. That's what they did. But he's not expressing any envy. He's not expressing any jealousy. He's not expressing some desire that their situations and conditions would be reversed. In fact, he's already expressed in the same letter that it's really a good thing that he's in prison, because it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard that he is in prison and in chains for Christ. But you could see how envy or how jealousy might block or subvert love. Paul didn't allow that to happen. Neither can we in our lives. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 30 says, a heart at peace, a heart that's content, we might say, gives life to the body, but envy rots the bone. If we're going to be love-first people, we have to be committed to ending envy. Love ain't jealous. Love ain't envious. Love is able to be happy for others. Love is able to rejoice with others, to seek the best for others, all while being hospitable and content for what one has. Maybe envy is a struggle in your life. I think it probably affects us all more than we want to admit. I want you to consider this week how you can grow in the practice of hospitality, how you can learn that secret of contentment that Paul spoke about. As always, we're here to serve you, our shepherds, our ministry staff. We love to hear from you. We miss seeing your faces and look forward to seeing you again very soon. God bless.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. You're given glory in creation, now revealed in you are Christ. What a beautiful name it is, what a beautiful name it is.
Thank you. For communion, let's go to God in prayer. Father God, thank you for this beautiful day you've given us today, and as we partake of your bread, Father God, which represents your body, help us to remember the sacrifice that you've made for us, giving us the opportunity to serve you and spread your word. Please accept our plea for forgiveness as we fall short as humans. We thank you for your mercy and guidance, Father God. Help us to always remember these things as we partake of the bread. In your Son's name, amen. Let's pray. Father God, we come to you again, and as we drink from the cup, allow for us to reflect on the sacrifices that you made for us so that we may one day be with you together in celebration. Father God, thank you for the opportunities you've given us to serve and be living examples of you. Please help for us to remember these things as times become difficult. Thank you for your sacrifice. In your Son's name I pray. Amen.
I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me.
You give and take away. You give. Lord bless.